When Steel Talks, everybody listens.
That's, to represent your music and your culture.
Disrespect.
Well, I use it. I know the people that in America still appreciate it.
We just heard what you use.
I try to give them the best that I can, or give them an idea. Every one of the biggest songs that I've ever written or been involved with is a song called Calypso Breakdown. And that was on my very first album, Sound of a Drum, 1976. Well, they put that song in the movie Saturday Night Fever, and it sold 45 million copies. 47, whatever. It keeps going. But, you know, it's like mind-blowing. You get to say to yourself, you know how many people heard that? Mm-hmm. You know, it's like I worked with Jimmy Buffett, and Robert Greenidge worked with Jimmy Buffett. Now, we just performed, just small example, last weekend up in Boston at Foxborough, which is where the New England Patriots play football, an outdoor stadium. 70,000 people this man put in this place. So that's 70,000 people, and Robert is really featured in the show. That's 70,000 people who never been to Trinidad in their entire life, don't know nothing about Trinidad, got to hear this pan. And everybody want to know, what is that? Where is it from? And they learning the history of Trinidad. Somebody let to go there for a carnival or something. Well, that's all positive. Now, we did two shows there. That's 140,000 people in 2 weeks to be hip to that band. Now, you multiply that times the 40 shows we do a year, and on an average of 50,000 people. You know how many millions of people that's getting exposed to this steel drum that never heard it and don't know what it, even after they hear it, they don't know what it is. Mm-hmm. People come up to me and ask me, how many hands he got? What are you talking about? You got two hands. It sounds like a whole band playing.
Well, it's interesting. I mean, you're talking about that. I'm going to digress just a bit. Robert is one musician in how many hands? How do you think these people would react to 120-plus steel orchestra?
They'd freak, they'll pass out. This is what we want.
Exactly.
Like the hairs on your paws raise up.
I think they'd be elevating.
I'm telling you.
Yeah.
They'd have to be if they heard. That's exactly
the
my
sight,
point. If they ever experienced 120 band players at Panorama Night, and that Savannah there, and you're getting it. You see, most people, you go to listen to that band. You know, I'm fortunate and lucky because I'm a musician and they know me. I'm inside. You go inside
the band, under the canopy.
You go inside there.
It's a spiritual experience.
You hear some stuff. Spiritual ain't the word for it. Jimmy Buffett one time did a tour and took Despots to Florida on a tour. And we wrote a song together. Him, Buffett, myself and Robert Greenidge. We wrote the song called King of Somewhere High. And he was staying in St. Bartholomew in the French Caribbean. And he came over because we were rehearsing the songs with Despots up the hill. And I pick him up, my wife, we driving up the hill. I won't even drive up the hill because that road,
it's winding.
She's from there, so she drives. She used to drive it. So she drove us up. And on the way up the hill, we started at the bottom, down there by the greens.
Yeah,
we
going Piccadilly.
Up, Piccadilly.
Yeah.
We going up the hill. And as we getting closer, halfway up the hill, he hearing the song in the car, and we hearing it faint, and he's saying, man, what is that? Then he said, man, that's our song. And I'm saying, yeah, Jimmy, I know we're going up the hill now. And the closer we get up the hills, the more you hear the song. And he wrote in his book, A Pirate Looks at 40, this was an out-of-body experience for him. He said he couldn't believe it, just to hearing that sound going up the hill. This white boy, where nobody know white don't go up that hill, police or not. You know, you know, going up there. But, I mean, this experience with him was like, he went up to here. He went up to Desperados. And nobody killed him. He came back alive, you know. It was a big thing, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, my God.
This white guy got up there from, you know, Mississippi.
Mr. Jimmy Buffett.
And he came back out cool. And he, matter of fact, he loved it. He told Rob, we got to go up there again.
That's what year was this? About?
This was King of Somewhere High. This was probably 96, something like that.
All right.
And it was just a great experience. Mm-hmm. And just going up that hill and hearing that music, And when he finally got up the hill and he could hear it, it was like, it was some experience that he said in his book he would never forget for the rest of his life. So it's that kind of experience that the steel drum does to people.
And the thing is, it's actually happening right here in America, in New York.
It's happening all over.
Yeah, because you have 100-piece orchestra.
Well, that's
it. You have
at
least
three
of them happening at the New York Panorama.
Well, that's the point. You see, you
and
got
still,
bands.
And still, you have these people not really
you haven't mentioned
aware.
England, Miami.
And Japan
you
is
know,
not far
Japan,
behind.
Please. Switzerland.
Yeah.
You know, all in Europe, it's just everywhere.
It's
an
explosion.
I remember going and playing the Blue Note in Japan, and I took Robert Greenidge on the gig with me. Mm-hmm. And there was Japanese girls and guys bringing their steel drum to the Blue Note Club to have Robert. No, they ain't jamming with us. They have Robert sign it.
That's nice.
Yeah.
That's nice.
But I mean, just the you know, it's
the
like
reference.
Yeah, it's shocking, you know what I'm saying? You know, it's my show, it's my all them people, and I'm saying, Robert, some people outside want you to sign some stuff. Me?
Yeah.
Yeah, Robert, you. You go outside. I say, man, she got a drum, a steel drum. Get out of here. Yeah, Robert, she got the tenor pan.
Yes.
Case. Big Trinity flag on the case.
Yeah, they do.
I said, okay. He say, wow. You know. Mm-hmm. And then we even did I got Robert to do some interviews with the drum magazines and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It was really fun, and the people was very, they love it. They love anything musical. And when Robert played Stardust, well, forget
about
it. Oh,
yeah. That just literally brought the house down in the
Well, they love classical music in the first place over there. That's the biggest seller in Japan, classical
mm-hmm.
music, believe it or not. And it's a huge industry. And Robert played Stardust.
Mm-hmm.
And, I mean, you can see people just, the looks on their faces.
Well,
they was
cry.
Just like people sitting down. You're in the club. You're eating, you're drinking. Yeah. Robert started playing Stardust. People do like this. They lean up on their chairs and they listen, and it's like, it's just, you know, even when he got off stage, he was like, wow, man, them people over here know that? Yeah, Robert, they know that, you know. And that's what the beauty of it, because it's music.
Mm-hmm.
You see, music is the only international language we have.
Yes.
Okay, you can be from Timbuktu. You play some good music that you like, I like, we gonna listen to it. When we go to these foreign countries and don't speak the language
there's
and stuff,
a communication with
just,
music,
there you go. It's the music. That's the thing.
Mm-hmm.
So
language,
you know, we're lucky and fortunate in one way to be involved with an international language,
mm-hmm.
because there's nothing else other than love crosses the borders.
We know that,
and we know you know it's fine line between that love and hate.
Mm-hmm.
But music is just straight ahead. You know,
gotcha.
It didn't do nothing. You can't love it. You can't hate it. You just gotta just enjoy it. However the flow taking you, you gotta go.
Gotta
so
go with it.
You know, I'm really happy and thrilled about that, to be able to be around players like Robert Greenidge or Booksy. Or Professor or Leon Teague is good too.
Oh yeah, whoever
you know,
it is. Yeah.
It's people they're coming on, you mm-hmm. know, and you just give them a chance. And give them a, you know, all it takes is a listen. And just most people just still back in the days of that's ping pong, you know. Or I remember guys who come up to me and say, boy, Ralph, was that a steel drum? Yes, I like that instrument. You know, it's always out of tune, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
What's out of tune? What instrument are you listening to?
And also, in New York, there's a chronic thought process. You tell people, some of them, about the steel pan, and they're like, what do you mean those things that they play in the subway?
Yeah.
And that's their concept of what pan is about.
No.
So, you know, what you described in terms of, you
that
know, those 70,000
people.
That
band could stand up right next to Pavarotti, God bless him.
Yeah.
That's how
that
I feel about that band.
Mm-hmm.
Don't tell me about no train. You understand? No, because when I was small, I used to go on a train and beat my conga drum and bong, you know. My body lies over the ocean. And I got a little bowl there, put some pennies in.
Yeah.
Well, that's when you're a kid. You do kiddish things. When you get to be a man and a real musician, you do real things. You do man things.
Yeah.
You do music things.
Yes.
And that pan, again, it's not nothing to do with no train. That's the old-time foolishness. That pan is a piano. That pan can stand up with the right person behind it. You take a Booksy Sharp or a Robert Greenidge and put them next to Pavarotti, and I guarantee they hold their own.
Of course.
You know, and some more. Put a little fire underneath them.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, I'm telling you. So this is what you got, you know, this is how I feel about that instrument.